محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, night 25 and of the odd nights of this blessed month of Ramadan. And subhanAllah, only a few days left of this month. And if we haven't done enough, then inshaAllah, it's still not too late. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges actions at the beginning, how we do it and how we end it. So if we end off well, even if we didn't begin very well and during Ramadan we didn't do much, if we end off strongly, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge us according to that. So as tired as we are and as ill as we are, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to end off very well. Someone also asked me with regards to illness, if you're not able to commit as much as you used to do. There's a beautiful hadith that says, anyone who made the witr or any act of ibadah, and due to illness or travel, is unable to maintain that ibadah, then Allah writes it for him. That he will get that full reward for it, because his niyyah was there and he was consistent, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused him not to be able to do it. So Allah gives him the reward, so we shouldn't feel bad. And it's not in part of taqwa to abuse your body. That if it is, if you're ill or you're not able to do something, then we don't force our body. That is not what Allah wants to for us to punish our body. But rather the taqwa is we do as much as we can. And if we are unable to continue, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most grateful and oft forgiving. So alhamdulillah, we ask Allah to grant us in this night 25 to do the most that we can with the remains of this Ramadan. Ameen. Tonight, inshallah, we talk about Surah Al-Masad or Surah Al-Lahab. And this is a unique surah. And I know the order, we have changed the order, but we should have done Surah Inna Al-Tainaka Al-Kawthar. We will get to that tomorrow, inshallah. But this surah is quite unique in that it is the only chapter in the Quran where an entire chapter is dedicated by Allah to really curse somebody. And there are a few people, a few criminals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse in the Quran, like Fir'aun, Abu Jahl, Mughira, Al-Walid bin Mughira, Khalid bin Walid's father. And these other criminals, they're not mentioned by name, but they're mentioned indirectly, and they're part of a greater surah, whereas the entire theme of the surah is not about them. Whereas this man, Allah has cursed him, an entire surah dedicated to him and his wife. And in fact, Allah usually does not mention the names of these criminals. Fir'aun gets a mention. Haman gets a mention, Qarun gets a mention. Abu Jahl's name isn't in the Quran. Al-Walid bin Ughira, his name is not mentioned in the Quran. Umayyah, the guy who abused Bilal, his name isn't mentioned in the Quran. But Abu Lahab, he is mentioned by name in the Quran, which means, you know, a special wa'yadu billah kind of curse by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By name, he'll be mentioned until all eternity that he's cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what did this man do to get this kind of curse? So number one, we need to know that there are four uncles of the Prophet ﷺ that are mentioned in his life. The Prophet had a number of uncles, but four of them really played a part in his life. Two of them are from Jannah, and two of them are unfortunately in Jahannam. And the one in Jahannam is the most severe of those in Jahannam, of the worst of the worst, and that's Abu Lahab. And then the other is of the best of the people of Jahannam, and that's Abu Talib. In fact, it's mentioned that he's the least punished person of the kuffar in Jahannam. He will have shoes that he will wear in Jahannam, that only his feet will be in the fire, yet he will still feel like he's being punished the most of any person in Jahannam. May Allah protect us. Of the other two uncles of the Prophet ﷺ, one is the best of the best in Sayyid Shuhada, which is Hamza radiallahu anhu, and the other was the last person to make hijrah. For a very long time, he was a 50-50 Muslim. Not really this side, not that side. And finally, right before the conquest of Makkah, he had the, you know, the strength of Iman to make the hijrah. And this is Al-Abbas, the famous Sahabi Ibn Abbas, his father, radiallahu anhum. Abu Lahab, he, as we said, is the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ. And his name was Abdul Uzza. And there was an idol called Uzza. So his real name is Abdul Uzza. But his kunya, his nickname, as we could call it, is Abu Lahab. Now, Abu is usually after your son or your daughter, Abu Muhammad, or the Prophet ﷺ's kunya, what was it for a prize? Abu al-Qasim, because his eldest son was al-Qasim. But not always are you named after your eldest child. Sometimes it is given to you as a name of honor, like Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr didn't have a child called Bakr. Bakr means camels. So he's called Abu Bakr because wealth. He was a very wealthy man. Sayyidina Ali, for example, his kunya was Abu Turab. Why? Father of dust. Because the Prophet ﷺ came to the masjid one day. Oh, well, he went to Fatima one day. And he asked, where's Ali? So she said, look, we had a fight. He walked out of the house. I don't know where he is. He's probably in the masjid. Right? So even Sahaba. So he comes to the masjid and he finds Sayyidina Ali lying in the masjid. You know, a bit upset. And the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ didn't have carpets. There was dust. So the Prophet sees Sayyidina Ali lying and he's covered in sand. And he gives him like a nickname, Abu Turab, come, father of dust. Come, get up now, come. Let's reconcile. But because the Prophet gave him this nickname as a means of fun, he loved it so much that was his nickname. So his name isn't Abu Hassan. Sayyidina Ali's name isn't Abu Hassan. It's Abu Turab. Abu Lahab, this nickname was a nickname that he loved. And they gave him this nickname. Lahab actually means fire, a red fire, because he was fair with a touch of red in his skin. And this was a beautiful feature of the Arabs. So he liked that name. And therefore Allah actually uses this name in the surah, gives him a nickname that he likes, but you'll see Allah has changed the meaning for something else. That he's not the father of fire in terms of the complexion. He really is Abu Fire, the man who will go to fire. See how Allah changes his nickname. So the Prophet ﷺ had given Abu Lahab the da'wah of the first people. He was actually the neighbor of the Prophet ﷺ. They lived side by side. And two of the Prophet's daughters, Ruqayya and Kulthum, were actually married to two sons of Abu Lahab. They weren't living together, but they were married. And when the Prophet ﷺ gave him da'wah, he was so abusive and insulting in his response that he broke those engagements. And he said, from now on until, you know, forever, I am your enemy. And there are narrations where other members of the Quraysh said, non-Muslims, said they never saw a neighbor so abusive to another neighbor, that the wife of Abu Lahab, she would get her menses blood and the feces of the house, and they would make a point of throwing it in the house of the Prophet ﷺ, and he would have to clean it up. And that when the Prophet ﷺ would walk in the road, or would and his family would move around, Abu Lahab would make a point of cursing them and spitting on them. In fact, he told his sons, go to Muhammad and break your marriages off with his daughters and spit on him. Subhanallah. So this level of crudeness, even the worst of the Quraysh didn't do. And of the worst things Abu Lahab did was when the Prophet ﷺ lost one of his sons, Abu Lahab actually gathered a party to celebrate and said, see, he's abtar. We'll talk about the word abtar, like inna atayna kalkawthar. Abtar means he's cut off of all lineage. You see, so when his sons had died, he had no more sons, he had a party to celebrate. You see, Muhammad is abtar. So this level of cursing, the Prophet never responded to him. And Allah says in the Quran that we, Muhammad, don't worry, we will take care of those who insult you. And it's very relevant in this day and age, when people draw pictures and cartoons of the Prophet ﷺ. So where the surah came down, when the Prophet ﷺ, after 2 years, 3 years of giving the message secretly, the Prophet was now given the instruction, give the da'wah publicly, go and call people to Islam publicly. So he climbed Mount Safa in the middle of Makkah, and he called the people, O Quraysh. And when someone does this, it usually means that there's an enemy attacking. So the Quraysh all gathered around Mount Safa and said, what's going on? So the Prophet also said, if I told you that there's an army coming towards Makkah to attack you, will you believe me? So the Quraysh said, yes, we believe you, Asadiqul Amin. So he said, I'm warning you about a coming disaster. I'm telling you about the calamity. Qiyamah is coming. So as the Prophet was giving his sermon, his first public sermon, Abu Lahab stood up and shouted. He of course heard about Islam before. He said, is this why you called us? Tabban lak and tabban lak. May you be ruined. May you be ruined twice. Tab means to be ruined and destroyed. May you be disintegrated and completely thrown to pieces. So when he said that, Allah sent down a revelation. Allah said, tabbat yada abi lahabi wa tab. Doomed are the hands of Abu Lahab, and doomed is he. And this is Allah has made a promise that now he is cursed. Him and he will be cursed forever. مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُ مَالُهُ وَمَا كَسَبْ. His wealth and his gains and everything he acquired shall not benefit him in the least. He will lose his wealth, and kasab also means his children. Kasab usually means that which you have acquired, your children. His wealth will leave him and his children will leave him and not help him. سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَا تَلَهَبْ. He will go to a fire that is lahab. He's going to a fire called Lahab. That flaming red fire, he's going to such a place. وَامْرَأَتُهُ And his woman, حَمَّالَةَ الْحَطَبْ She will be the one who carries the firewood. An interesting nuance here in the Quran. There's two ways of mentioning wife in the Quran. Zawj and Imra. Imra means woman. And Zawj is wife or spouse. And usually where there's some, and when you recite the Quran in your khatam, look at where Allah uses the word Imra. Usually there's something missing in that marriage. So Allah will say, Asiya was the Imra of Fir'aun. Wasn't his partner, because there was something missing in that marriage. Also, if there's a child missing, so Allah will say, Zakaria says, my Imra is barren. Nabi Zakaria, my wife is barren. Then when she gets a baby, when she gets Yahya, she becomes his zawj. You see, that now the marriage is complete. Same with Imra'at Lutin wa Imra'at Nuh. That these women are the wives of these Anbiya, but they were not their partners. So Allah calls this lady, she is the Imra of Abu Lahab. Why? Because she helped him in his destruction. So as she helped him in his destruction, she will help him in the punishment, in his punishment in Jahannam. And she would have this necklace around her neck. Her most prized possession was a very expensive necklace. And she would go to the Prophet ﷺ and say, I swear on this necklace and by Al-Uzza, I would spend, even if the last thing I have was this necklace, I would spend it to curse you and your family. So Allah said about this necklace, fi jidiha habalum min masad, that around her neck will be a rope of date palms. And in fact, it's fi jidiha. It could actually mean inside her chest. There is this date palm necklace that is going to pull her tight. So it's mentioned the punishment of Abu Lahab is that he will be put in this extreme burning fire, and his wife as well. And to add for her the punishment, she will gather the wood each day. حَمَّالَةَ الْحَدَابِ means the one who will continuously gather the firewood. So every single day, she will go gather the firewood of Jahannam, to which the two of them will be burnt, وَإِيَّاذُ بِاللَّهِ And they will be, she'll have this rope tied around her neck, while he is just being punished all the time, وَإِيَّاذُ بِاللَّهِ And what's amazing about the surah, there's a book on the miracles of the Quran, and they put this surah as one of the miracles of the Quran. Do you know why? Because this surah was revealed 10 years or more than 10 years before Abu Lahab died. That if Abu Lahab said, I embrace Islam, khalas, the whole Quran falls apart. Because this Quran says you're going to Jahannam, Abu Lahab. It never occurred to Abu Lahab or his wife to say, well, if I'm going to Jahannam according to the Quran, what if I accept Islam even on the outside? I say, La ilaha illallah, khalas, then this Quran doesn't make sense anymore. Allah had basically said, you are not going to become Muslim and you will die on kufr. And if he only embraced Islam, it would have saved him, and it would have, well, not saved him, it would have ruined the Quran completely. But Allah showed that no matter what he does after that, because he transgressed to a certain level, Allah shut his eyes and his mind off completely. Abu Lahab, how he died, he was one of the few criminals that did not go to Badr. All the major criminals went to Badr, Abu Jahl, Umayyah, and they all died there. Abu Lahab didn't go to Badr, but Allah intended for him to die as well on Badr. So when he heard the news that the people of Badr were defeated, he became extremely angry, and he started abusing one of the Muslim women in Makkah. So she hit him on the head with a spear, and this wound became infected. And within 1 week, his body completely covered in sores. He was like rotting alive. That his, when he died, his own children didn't want to bury him. They paid for someone outside of Makkah to carry his body outside of Makkah and dump it in a hole, because they were afraid with the kind of rotting the way his body looked. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, we'll take away your wealth, your children, your beauty, everything, and then you'll go to Jahannam to be burned where you belong. Prophet ﷺ didn't curse this man. Allah says that Allah will take care of those who curse the Prophet ﷺ. And that's why when being an enemy is one thing, but when you go beyond, and especially the family of the Prophet ﷺ, if you harm the family of the Prophet ﷺ, it's an added kind of personal insult to the Nabi ﷺ. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intervenes. Similarly, if this is what happens to those who hate the Prophet ﷺ, the reward for loving the Nabi ﷺ is equally great and equally rewarding. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us to love the Nabi ﷺ, and may we be in a Jannah close to him. Ameen. I didn't mention this, and this is actually the question. I see Ubaid, beat me to it. The wife of Abu Lahab, her name was Urwa, and that is the answer of today's question. And tomorrow, inshallah, we'll do Surah Inna Atainaka Al-Kawthar. But yeah, so answer, so as long as you can read, then you'll get the answer today. So her name was Urwa, that was the wife of Abu Lahab. Inshallah, Qiyamul Layl from 9:30 to 10 o'clock, inshallah. And we'll continue, we'll do two surahs tomorrow. Inna Atainaka Al-Kawthar and Idha Jaa Nasrullahi Wal Fath, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa barakatuh.